Hello everyone. I promised you I make a follow-up video where I want to explain what went wrong with the last dataset. You know, in the last video we had some problems with assembling the mitochondrial genome. Basically, there was quite a lot of distance between the reference genomes and our reads, which we downloaded. Turns out that we actually downloaded the wrong reads. We have here the files which we have downloaded in the last tutorials. And I was assuming this is a stonefly. There was this problem that the name of the species here is a butterfly, but the species here in the taxonomy is a stonefly we want to work on. We did then to check that we are using the right reads, that this is indeed the stonefly, do a blast search where we took some mitochondrial reads of Mesocapnia, the stonefly we are working on, from another genus, so not the same species but the same genus, and I have the ID in here. And then we used the SRA data and we blasted this against it, and this were the results here. We did find a lot of hits, and it turns out that the identity is 84%. In the first video of the tutorial series I did say that should be fine. Turns out that's not the case. This was completely wrong. I'm apologizing for this. I was assuming it's the same genus, but still, for the same genus, this percent identity is way too low. So I completely screwed that up. And as it turns out, I have then blasted some data of the dwarf genome against the complete NCBI database. So you remember we assembled some data and we were able to get at least some pieces of the mitochondrial genome assembled using the reads which we downloaded. And when I blasted all of that against the database, we did see that indeed we get a lot of butterfly hits in mitochondrial genomes which are online. So we did indeed download the wrong data, and this also explains why it was so incredibly difficult to assemble the reads against the Plecoptuan reference genomes. Nevertheless, the methods and the workflow and approach are still the same, so it doesn't change anything in the tutorial and workflow. It's just that the data is really not usable and it's the wrong data. So what I did next was I looked at the bioproject. Again, this is a file of the study where all the data used in the study, where we obtained our sequences from, are stored. And we see here that we have 32 SRI experiments. And if we look in the paper, we see that we have 32 different species. And I wanted to figure out, okay, which one is the one of Mesocapnia? There is one data set of Mesocapnia somewhere in there. So what I did do next to find the right one is I entered again the Mesocapnia sequence of CO2, which is an NCBI, and then I added all the SRR experiments from that study and blasted it against that. And if we take a look at the results, we see that we find some hits which have a much higher identity, so 98%. This is perfect. This is exactly what we are looking for. This makes sense that we have some sequences of a Mesocapnia. We don't know the exact species, but only the genus. And then we have our Mesocapnia species, and they have still 98% identity, which is something that we can expect. So we take a look which SRR this is, and this is the number here. So I opened it up, and this is indeed the right one. So this is Mesocapnia, the data itself, but then the taxonomy is wrong. So this is from a king crab. Anyway, this now is our final data. It is indeed from the stonefly. We have just verified that again. And I'm going to download this data as we did before and import it into Genius. And I quickly run through the steps and we see if we have an easier time assembling this genome. And I'm quite confident that we can assemble the complete genome because we have quite a lot of reads. So this is 46 million reads, so a lot more than last time. And I have already imported this into Genius. And I have made a new folder. This is called MitoMesoNew. And I have in here my reads. I now going to again extract the 101 sequences from the left and right side. And as before, I'm going to run a blast search afterwards. Also, I increased the memory I assigned to Genius and Self. You can do this in the preferences of Genius in here, because it takes quite a lot of memory to load that much data. I just realized that the length in here this time is 200. So we're just going to extract 100 base pairs in here. So we go from the right to the left and select 100 base pairs like this. And you scroll down and select it here as well. We go and extract. And this, as I said, those are quite a lot of sequences, will take even longer. So I'll see you back in a minute. Alright everyone, turns out that extracting all those 46 million sequences is a bit much for Genius. Even with 5.4 million, it's still a bit difficult for Genius, because I only have 16 gigabytes of RAM to handle this amount of data. However, I extracted those 5 million sequences and did run a blast search against the complete database containing the mitochondrial plecoptilin reads and also the mesocapnia sequences. Here you can see the settings I used. This will take quite a while. And next I will show you the results of this blast search. We have them here. We did find 1800 reads and have assembled those to the reference genome of Pteonarchis princeps. I show you also the settings for this. I used high sensitivity / medium and I iterate up to 10 times. These are the results right here. And if we zoom in, we see that the coverage is quite good, but also you notice that you have quite a lot of mismatches, always in the first position of the read. This is a bit weird, so we see, for example, this read here is forward, and we have here a T, and this is the case for most other reads. This is indicating that we did extract the sequences wrong. So if we go back, let's cancel this one, to our original sequences. This is only the length of 200, so I was assuming those are 100-100, but as it turns out, it's probably 101 and 99 in length for the forward and reverse read. So we're going to reduce extraction, and I'm also going to extract less sequences. So let's say maybe 3 million should be fine. This way, Genius will be a bit quicker, and we have an easier time handling this sequence data. I also will extract the right and the left side for the 3 million sequences. So here we first going to select 99 bases. And we select 3 million and extract those. We have now a subset of the left and right read of the paired end reads from around 3 million sequences. There's one last thing we have to do before we use those to blast them against our reference genome. We can use our new consensus sequence to actually find and verify that we are using the best reference genome from the mitochondrial plecoptilin reads, which we have available on NCBI. So let's copy a big chunk of our consensus. This is already our mesocapnia genome, and we're going to go to BLAST, nucleotide BLAST, and paste the sequence in here. Of course, we should write in here mitochondrial genome as a query. So we only get complete mitochondrial genomes as results. Select somewhat similar, and we click on BLAST. So here we have our results, and let's take a look. And it looks like indeed Pteonarchis princeps is our best hit with 80% identity. So we're going to continue using it as our reference genome. Also some other plecoptans we have in here, for example, Dinocras, Cephalotus, and those have a higher genetic distance. So let's go back into Genius. And in here we're going to start a new blast search. Let's try the left one first. And we can keep settings in here. We are using again all mitochondrial genomes in the database, so all plecoptan genomes which are online, and we can click on search. I will do this now for both the left and the right reads, and then we will assemble the genome. So the blast searches for both left and right side from the 3 million sequences is done, and we can now select all of those and use map to reference to assemble our reads. We're going to use high sensitivity, medium, and iterate up to 10 times. We can click on OK. We have here our assembly, and let's take a look at it. And we quickly go through it and see if there are any errors or any sequences which are not looking too nice. Because if we use this consensus sequence as a search query to find additional reads, we want to make sure that we have not too many errors in here. Let's zoom in a bit. And we see that we have still the problems with the letters here. So I'm not exactly sure what is going on here. Let's take a look at this. Looks like some sequences now are fine and some are a bit off. Yeah, not all of them have this mismatches in the beginning, but I guess there's not much we can do about that. Actually, it doesn't change the sequences much. It isn't a big problem, so we're just going to keep it for now and don't really mind it. So we're going to go through those sequences, and whenever we find some sequences with a lot of mismatches, we should remove them. Let's zoom out maybe a bit more. This is fine, but if we find a lot of sequences which are mismatches, we should definitely get rid of those. Yeah, for example, this sequence is here. We should definitely delete them, even though they're probably not affecting the consensus in any way, just to make sure. So this does look a bit better now. And it doesn't matter if we catch some sequences which are okay, because we're going to reassemble the whole data set anyway using the complete reads. Let's save this. You really want to make sure that you get the edges of the sequences right. Let's delete those here as well, so we are sure that these are actually A's. So you have to be confident about the edges of the sequences, because the next additional reads are going to be mapped, continued from here. Alright everyone, I'm done editing and I removed almost the complete control region, because there it's really difficult to map the reads against and you can get a lot of errors. And I also cleaned up the sites where we have some gaps. So now we can export the consensus sequence of mesocapnia, and then use the Genius map to reference to map all the blast hits against this consensus sequence. This way we can find additional hits, and we're going to extend the regions, like for example this region here from the side, and we're going to map our hits continuously. So if we get some more hits, we make some new ground here, and we can then again use this information to search again against all our sequence hits which we have downloaded. So we're going to use the complete 3 million sequences and have several iterations of mappings. So this way we don't have to do this manually by adding new blast databases and so on, like we did do this in the tutorial for the 454 data. So we're going to use the basic Genius map to reference algorithms, and we're going to see how this turns out. So let's start by exporting the consensus sequence. Let's call this one draft A. Actually, let's call this draft A edited. And we will give the assembly the same name. Let's copy this document. And we're going to add it here, where we have the rest of our reads. Let's try it with the left side first. We're going to go on map to reference. Let's select the medium to low sensitivity, because we are now mapping 3 million reads. It should be fairly quick. And let's say we iterate for the first time. We're going to just choose 5 iterations to see if this strategy works and if we can actually close some gaps. Let's then select here custom sensitivity, so we can copy the settings from the low sensitivity. But in here, we want to make sure that we have a minimum overlap of, let's say, 50 bases. And we should reduce the mismatches to, let's say, a maximum of 5%, so that we only get very well matching sequences. Let's try this with the settings here. We click on OK. And you already see this will take quite a while. So I'll see you back in a few minutes. The assembly is done now and we can take a closer look. We can see right away that it was able to close some gaps here. And I think we should zoom in and see what happened. So in the first version, we were not really sure what belonged here. But then by remapping our hits, Genius was able to get really well coverage of this area here. So probably this region had a very high genetic difference to the reference genome. And therefore, Genius was not able to find the right hits. But now, as we have our first dwarf genome used to map our reads, we see that the coverage wasn't a problem and this worked really well. Let's take a look at some other regions. We see here that we did cover some ground and were able to fill some of those question marks with sequences. However, we still have a gap. This could be because we don't have enough coverage, or the other reason could be that we didn't use enough iterations. Let's also take a look at the control region. This is kind of the most important part. And we see here that we didn't really cover that much ground. So what I would do in the next step is to remove maybe some sequences here from the consensus sequence, because those might be wrong. And then we let it try it again. Also, in the next try, we should add also the left and right side. This time we just used the left side. And actually, as I'm thinking about exporting the sequences again and just deleting one base from the right side, so I figure out what exactly is going on with those extra letters here, because they might also interfere with the assembly process. It's much nicer if we get sequences which doesn't have a mismatch. So let me quickly export some more sequences. Maybe I also increase the amount of sequences, let's say maybe 5 million. I will try it out and I'll be back in a second. I just noticed another thing. It looks like there's some regular pattern in the way those sequences are arranged, because we have quite a lot of sequences which have the same mismatch. So this is kind of a problem. I mean, probably not a big problem, but something to think about for maybe next time or future projects, that if we have some regularity in our sequences and we make a subset by basically taking just 1 million sequences from here to down 1 million, we kind of introduce an artificial bias into our data. So the best thing actually would be to generate a script which takes, let's say, 2 million sequences from this data set at random. I am not really concerned that it's a problem in this case, but it's something I just wanted to point out to you. So to think about, maybe for some other projects that actually is important. But for now, I'm going to select not sequences from the beginning. I'm just going to take them, let's say, from 10 million and I say 3 million sequences starting from here. Alright everyone, I just wanted to point out another thing. If you extract sequences, you can extract them from the left side, and then you can just click on extract, and this should work fine. They will load instantaneously if you click on this file here. However, if you extract sequences from the other side and click on extract, it will keep the position where extracted those sequences, and this makes it really difficult for Genius to load those sequences if you click on the file. So the best thing is for the right sequences to actually make a file, and then you select 100 base pairs from this side here. Like this, you would select all of them, and you can go on allow editing, and then it will warn you that you need to load this document into memory, and then you're just going to do that and you delete those sequences here. This will make those starting from one here, and then both documents like this will load instantaneously. Also, I have assembled both of them against our draft genome, and the interesting thing we see here is that we have again those two gaps which remained, and I kind of don't think that this is a coverage problem. I'm pretty sure that we have the problem here, that the sequences on the left or right side, maybe they have some errors which we didn't detect. So the best thing is to maybe we can try to delete some sequences here and here in the dwarf genome, and we try if this solves this coverage problem here. Also, we're going to do the same thing for the other positions where gaps are remaining. So let's try this out. We're going to close down this document and make a copy of this one here. Let's call this one draft B. And we're going to zoom in. And let's just take maybe 20 bases. And we're going to delete those. This is also a great test to see if our method in generally works, because we know we had some coverage over this region, and we will see if we can get this coverage again just by extending our left and right regions where we have no sequence information. Let's try to find the other regions in here. Here we have some question marks. And also here I'm going to delete 20 bases. Like this, but I also want to include 20 question marks again for that. Those are 20, and I copy those to the left side where I delete 20 bases as well. Like this. Let's save this, and we're going to do that for the other regions as well. Okay, I have changed this in all the flanks, in the flanking regions. Let's minimize this again. Oh, and by the way, there's another thing. As you can see here, I did make a new assembly, and we don't have this problem that we have mismatches on the edges. As it turned out, dividing those SRR reads, the sequence data we downloaded, 100-100 was actually the right thing, so 101 and 99 didn't make any sense at all. So this is the reason why we had those spots here. So just divide your sequences 100 base by 100 base, like we basically have done here, and everything should be fine again. Now it's time to assemble the whole thing again with several iterations and so on. And as it turns out, it's really a question of the fine settings. So I did try it a bit, and I found a setting which actually was able to close those gaps here. However, I still need to optimize it a bit, because it also tries to close this gap here by basically extending the length of the sequences. One potential solution could be to maybe replace those question marks here with ends, and this is what I'm going to try next. Let me maybe quickly show you which settings I used to assemble this here. Well, maybe let's actually do this again to make really sure that we get the settings right. Let's delete this document. And we again going to assemble this with B. We choose map to reference, and this time I choose medium sensitivity. even though advanced here that might not be able to compute this, it should be fine. And then we go on custom sensitivity. And then here we choose a maximum mismatches per read of 10. And we want to have a minimum overlap of 50. This should be fine. The gap size probably doesn't do anything because we have question marks and we should replace them with ends, but I'm not really sure about if that works. We will try it in the next step. But first, let's first reproduce this. With this, it should assemble our reads just fine, that only the control region is missing, and then we can form again the consensus sequence and save that as dwarfed C. And maybe also one thing I wanted to point out, when you're watching things being assembled, it's a good indication to take a look at how many were matched in the first iteration, and sitting in front of your computer and watch how many sequences are added in each iteration. It should be around 50 to 100. If only a few sequences are added each time, let's maybe say 10, your settings are too restrictive. And if too many sequences are added, your settings are too relaxed. And also the problem is that sometimes it closes the gaps really quickly. So as we did see in the example before, it did close the complete control region just by closing the gap and accepting a huge gap in the sequence itself. And just to give you an idea how many sequences are added in each iteration, I'm going to write this down. So see you back in a minute. All right, now it's done and this is looking really great. I just give you the numbers on the screen. It took 5 iterations to construct this one here. And it did add around like 50 sequences in each step. However, as I told you before, it closes the gap here. So this is absolutely not correct. Let's zoom in here. And we're going to go to this side here. I would say this is probably still correct up to this point here, where other sequences are coming in. So I'm just going to add a little annotation here that reminds me to delete those sequences here. And we zoom in here as well. And let's check out what did go wrong here. And it did think those are matching. It's a bit problematic that it creates a big gap and then this counts as a good hit. Let's see if we get rid of these problems in the settings. So now it's just a question of fine-tuning. The method itself works, but we need to get the settings exactly right that it will continue to fill the complete control region with sequences. But in principle, this is working really well. Now it's just a lot of trial and error. Let me also annotate this region here. And we're going to save this. Let's also save this one here as dwarfed B. And we also add that we used 3 million sequences from the left side. The coverage itself is fine, so we don't need to add the right sequences in there as well. We can now extract this consensus. Let's click on OK. And we call this one dwarfed C. Let's take a closer look in here. And as I feared, indeed, the question marks are not counting as a gap. So we told Genius, don't make gaps bigger than 50 base pairs, but it ignores question marks completely. So what we are going to do is we're going to delete this one here. Click on Allow Editing. And let's insert ends in here. And we're going to save this for now. And we go back to our original assembly. And we're going to try to get an idea how big this control region roughly is. So let's click in here. So this is around 1,200 bases. And we now need to insert that many ends in here. Let's zoom in. So you can do this by simply copying and pasting. We start by inserting some ends. And then we copy it a few times. Let's see how many we have, a few more. So this should be about right. Let's save this one. And let's just try the same data set again against this dwarf genome with the same settings. So map to reference. Oh wait, this is the wrong one. We want the left one and dwarf C. Map to reference. Let's maybe review this again. Minimum overlap. Gap size. Let's maybe reduce this even to 30. And this should be fine. We can click on OK. And let's see if this gets a bit better. But in principle, this also just works beautifully. So we see that we have a very good coverage of the complete genome. There shouldn't be any big problems with the data. It's just a question of getting the last gap here filled. You maybe want to, once you get the settings right, run this overnight with, let's say, 1,000 iterations, and then it should fill this gap. Alright, I tried some different settings, but unfortunately I can't get it to continuously run. It always stops after a few iterations. So I basically started to take assemblies which look good, which extended the region where we have no information about by a bit. So we gain additional coverage. In this case, it's just 10 base pairs. But, well, at least it's something. So I'm still optimizing this, but at the moment it's getting kind of late, so I probably should go to bed, and I will try this the next days, and then I tell you what I came up with. Alright, I'm back and I have tried a few things. First of all, we have here the assembly based on our strategy with map to reference. You see, we have quite a good coverage. Then I also tried the program MitoBIM, which basically is doing the same thing using Myra. I tried this using the Mesocapnia CO2 gene sequence, which is online on NCBI, and also with the Pterinarchis reference genome, but both didn't give good results. This here is quite short, only 7,000 base pairs long. This might work from the length, but as you can see here, the coverage is a bit strange. So we get here, where the control region is, some weird peaks. And also, if you take a closer look inside the control region, let's have highlighting on, we can see that some things are going on which don't make too much sense. So we have a microsatellite in here, and it just took this microsatellite and extended it more and more, which is definitely not correct. You wouldn't find a microsatellite which is 300 base pairs long in a mitochondrial genome. So this also didn't really work. Then I tried using the data inside of Genius to make an assembly with the Myra, how it is implemented in Genius itself. I used 1 million reads for those two assemblies here. We see here that Myra did assemble some things, but when we take a closer look and make an alignment with the complete data set, let's first generate the consensus sequences. You can click on here. Sequence list should be fine. We can then also annotate those. We can click on annotate from. And let's select our reference genome in here. You can click on OK. This will take a while. Now it's taking all the annotations from our reference genome, the Pterinarchis genome, and putting them onto here. Let's not mind this too much at the moment. We can just click on apply and on save. And then we're going to use multiple align to get an overview how well all of those things match each other. All right, let's take a closer look at this. In annotations, we can maybe deactivate some things. For example, the tRNRs are not that important. So we see that we have a very good coverage across the whole genome, except for the part where the control region is. We have one mismatch here, but other than that, all those strategies did create a very good genome in the coding region. However, let's take a closer look on here, and we can see that this isn't really matching at all. So the strategies didn't give a very good match of all the sequences, and also the dwarf D has some question marks in here, which are not really wanted, they're causing this big gap here. Let's at least take a look if we take only the sequences which we created with Myra, if those are consistent, can click on extract. And if we zoom in here, we see that we still have quite a lot of mismatches. So even though Myra did work quite well and did probably do a pretty good job in the ends of those sequences, it didn't really get the control region right, even though it did look like it, but it doesn't look like this worked very well. You can also turn off highlighting again. So you see here in this assembly, in the bottom one, we have a lot of repetitive regions, how you would expect for the control region, a lot of A and T richness. And the top one is a lot shorter, but also looks a bit repetitive just from the first look, if you compare those elements here. But all right, it doesn't matter. It doesn't look too good with the control region. I would say we create some more assemblies with Myra, and I will show you some more tricks I learned which might help us a bit. Let's delete those things again. And I told you last time that it's desirable to get a random sequence pool out of our next generation sequences. So we had around, I think, 64 million sequences, and we only want a subset of, let's say, maybe 1 million sequences. And I installed a little program, I will give you the link in the YouTube description below, which can actually do a random subset. It's called Random AFQ. And this is just a little script which is free, which you can download and install. We can change the directory, and then we're just going to run this program here. What this is doing, it is taking from our sequence files, those are the complete sequences downloaded from the SRR archive, and it will do a subset, a random subset, and it will take 1 million sequences. So we can copy this one here, and this is the document name where it's going to save those sequences. And we're going to paste it in here. It is strangely returning an error here, or a warning, which doesn't make too much sense for me, but it is doing the subsetting anyway, so I don't know exactly what is going on. So as long as the symbol here doesn't change, it's still working. We see this also in our task manager. If you take a look at the CPU, this should be the script itself. So let's wait a few minutes, and then we can import this file here into Genius, and we try the Myra assembly again. All right, this is done now, and we have here our file, which is a subset of 1 million sequences. Let's go back into Genius, and we're going to make a new folder. Call this 1 million try. And then here we're just going to drag and drop this file, and Genius will import it. It's done importing. And I'm quickly going to show you how easy it is to actually set paired and reads in this. You can just click on Sequence, Set Paired Reads. And here we select split each read in half. So those are the forward reads and then the reverse read concatenated. And you can just click here on OK. And this will set your paired and reads. So we have a little bit more information about our sequences, which can help a bit in the assembly process and also when we are taking a look at our results. All right, our paired and reads are done, and now we can go on de novo. And then here you can select Myra. You have to install this as a plugin. And we're just going to use the default settings, and we select Illumina data. Also, we want to have a quality level of accurate. We can click on OK. And this actually will take quite a while. On a long-term basis, I would recommend trying this again with the actual Myra 4.0, the standalone program on a desktop computer on this little MacBook here. I have to subset the read because otherwise it takes quite a long time to calculate and compute. But maybe we have better chances of assembling also the control region a bit better when we're using a big computer where we can, let's say, use 2 million sequences at once, or even the complete data set. But that's something we need to try out, and unfortunately I can't really share that with you, because the same thing with the MitoBin program. This runs on a Linux computer at our university, and I can't install recording software on there. So we're just going to try it again with Genius. So I will make several assemblies using random seeds of 1 million sequences. This is making assemblies de novo, and we see if we can get some consistent results out of this. So I see you back in a few minutes when the assembly is done. Alright, so my run has finished, however we didn't obtain any good results. So in the end I decided that it's not worth assembling the control region, because no strategy can really do the job with this Mito genome. So we used in the end Myra, a Genius mapping approach, and also the program MitoBIM. We were able to recover almost the complete mitochondrial genome except for the control region. This, however, is already enough to publish our results as a small mitochondrial genome announcement, and I have done this, and you find the link in the YouTube description below to the paper. So I hope you enjoyed this course. I know it was a bit confusing sometimes because it was more like a video blog and we made some mistakes, but in the end I hope you learned how to handle next generation sequence data, so the big data files from NCBI, which are several gigabytes worth of data. And yeah, I see you in the next tutorial. So if you want to let me know if you have any feedback or some comments, just put them in the comments below. So see you next time. Bye bye.